An invitation to share my ideas with you. I'm coming from the University of Ioannina in Greece, and I think that I am the only one who is not a psychologist today. So I apologize for this. Okay. My talk consists of four sections. The first one is about virtual reality. Virtual reality is an approach, virtual reality as technology. In the second section, I will tell something about pedagogical reasoning and affordances. And in the third section, I'll show you some virtual learning environments we have designed and developed. As you will see, my talk has many common points with the other speakers. So, I'll try to be brief, and the major applications I design are on physics, not only because physics are my basic studies, but also because physics is a difficult discipline with complex concepts, and it's a difficult paradigm to learn technologies. Okay. So some historical points. Firstly, in 1951, Ray Bradbury published The Welt, his novel The Welt, where children made their own world. We all know the series Star Trek, where the crew relaxes in holodeck, a space they design. And more recently, in the film The Avatar, people are transferred through their replicas to different worlds. So from these three examples coming from science fiction, we can imagine a first definition of virtual reality. And this is a quite recent definition by Kim. So virtual reality is a field of study that aims to create a system that provides a synthetic experience to its user or users. So we can say that this experience is synthetic, illusory, or virtual because the sensory stimulation to the user is simulated and generated by the system. Some history now. Maybe you all know that in 1956, the filmmaker Morton Helling presented Sensorama, a mechanical virtual display device simulating 3D stereoscopic vision, motion, color, stereo sound, and emulating aromas, wind, vibrations, and so on. Just a few years later, the scientist Evan Sutherland presented Sketchpad, an interactive computer graphic system. And later on, Miron Kruger, working on psychological and social aspects of technology, presented the video plays, a system which transferred the user's motion into the computer. And Miron Kruger was the first who introduced the term artificial reality. In the 80s, Thomas Furness presented the visually coupled system. As you can see, is a head-mounted display. And as you also can see, the first applications were military applications. In the 80s, again in the 80s, Jaron Lanier produced a data glove and iPhone, and he established his company, the VPL company, and he was the first who introduced the term virtual reality. In the same decade, Frederick Brooks Jr. developed Nanomanipulator, a stereoscopic and three-dimensional system with a software where the researcher could manipulate in small temporal and spatial sizes like this molecule. And in the decade of 2000, collaborative virtual worlds such as Second Life started populating. And nowadays, low-cost intuitive interaction systems continuously appear. Now we can have a little bit different definition of virtual reality, and we can describe virtual reality as a mosaic of technologies that support the creation of synthetic, highly interactive and multisensory three-dimensional spatial environments and worlds. These are quite different, which the participant experiences as the real ones. So the two key concepts of virtual reality are spatial, so we have spatial representations like this room, and the experiences of the participant. So you will notice that from now on I will use the term participant and not user, because the user is a part of the system in virtual reality. And one of the main characteristics, as we will see later, is the sense of presence, meaning that the user, the participant, feels like being there in the virtual environment or world. Okay, now to be clear, it's obvious that by the terms virtual environments and virtual worlds, we refer to virtual reality technologies and not to systems like LMSs or KMSs or CMSs, because there is a little mess in the literature, because some people think that e-learning, the general term of e-learning, can be traduced by virtual learning. Okay, so I will show you some different types of virtual reality systems. The first one is the desktop, or the window to the world. We can see an example here. We can see, view, observe the virtual environment through the computer screen. So it's like to open a window to a different world. This is the lake in our town, but it's the lake as it was 7 million years ago. So this is not an artistic representation, but it's a simulation. I'll be back to the term later. Okay? Another quite simple type of virtual reality, or almost virtual reality, is the QuickTime virtual reality, which can be based either to photographs or on graphics like this one. All of us know panoramas and scenes created by the new digital cameras or mobiles. So this is a virtual environment created by different parts of graphics, and the user stands at a point and is looking around him or her, okay, 30, okay, or a little bit up and down, and even more, the user can jump to another point, okay, stand there and look around, okay. And QuickTime VR can be a desktop system or can be a semi-immersive system like the domes, theaters, caves, cubes we all know. This is a video from a semi-immersive system. Okay. This is one of our application on archaeology and history learning. Okay, the user or the participant wears not goggles, but semi-transparent glasses, looking at a video wall or a computer screen. So he or she is in and feels the real world, but also he or she is in this virtual world. Okay, after that we have the full immersive systems where the user is cutting off the real world and is immersed in the virtual environment. And here we can see, because technology goes fast and fast, we can see a very cheap hand-mounted display, a cardboard system, and there is a smartphone inside there. And so the student is navigating, I think it's our planetary system. Okay? So she is not in the real world, but in the virtual world. And of course, as some colleagues told us before, we have the augmented reality systems that combine the real world with a virtual one. Okay, we can see a molecule in front of us. So, these are the main virtual reality technologies, and as we can see, we can have a full immersive system that could be an augmented reality system or a QuickTime VR system that can be a desktop system or a semi-immersive system. And I forgot to tell you the virtual worlds or multi-user virtual environments or distributed virtual reality systems were like Second Life, where many people are represented through their avatars. You can see there a collaborative task, the teacher and the student collaborative to solve a problem on stereochemistry. Okay? Now, seeing all these examples, I believe that we have a feeling that virtual reality has some applications in education. Okay, so let's see the specific, the unique technological characteristics that differentiate virtual reality technologies from other ICT systems. And these characteristics afford certain actions in these systems, and they reflect the affordances of virtual reality. Just a few highlights on affordances. The term introduced by Gibson long time ago. So an affordance signifies the perception of the environment of an agent in terms of the actions that can be afforded by it. Later on, Michals introduced a little bit different definition, saying that affordances are the actions permitted by an animal, by environmental projects, objects, sorry, events, places, surfaces, people, and so forth. And Norman transferred the term affordances to the interfaces field, and he proposed that an affordance is the property of objects to convey important information about how people could interact with them. Now, let's see what are the virtual reality affordances. First of all, we have the affordance of three-dimensional spatial representations. These are the virtual environments. A second one is autonomy. A virtual environment is there 24 hours all year and works if I'm there or not. Never mind. Okay? Important thing, important characteristic, important affordance is the representation of participants through their avatars and immersion of the participant in the virtual environment. So, often there is a confusion between the terms immersion and presence. As we can see, presence is a psychological term, you know better than me, but immersion is a technological term. In order to be immersed in a virtual environment, I have to use specific equipment like a head-mounted display. So, not all the virtual environments are immersive. Another important affordance is the multisensory, intuitive, and real-time interaction the participant feels and has with the system, and natural semantics for the representation of objects and facts. A river is a river inside a virtual environment, and it is not just a blue line. Okay, participants may have first-person user point of view. I'm there, and I'm looking here and there. And so, I may have first-order experiences in the virtual environment. We can change size, our size, in space and time, as we will see later. And we may feel being there in the virtual environment, so we may have a sense of presence. And finally, there are the affordances of transduction reification, meaning that we represent some concepts in the environment. Now, the important thing for education is to transfer virtual reality to learning affordances, because learning is interested in. So learning affordances are action referential properties of the virtual environments that might lead to learning benefits. And what are the learning affordances of virtual reality? We propose that the learning affordances are, first of all, creation. We can build inside the virtual environment. We can build a building. Or scripting. We can write a code to do something with the behaviors of the virtual objects, or to teach computer programming. Free navigation. Free navigation is another learning affordance, meaning that we can freely navigate inside the virtual environment, go here or there. So we can have virtual field trips and tours. We can use modeling and simulation, like visualizations, and have virtual experiments, for example. We can communicate by various channels, verbal or non-verbal ones. We can collaborate and cooperate, for example, in order to solve problems or to play games. And we can have content presentation and delivery, using, for example, Sludl. Sludl is an LMS, is the Moodle for the multi-user virtual environments. We can have shared interactive whiteboards inside the virtual worlds and work like the real ones, or we can give lectures like this one. Okay, so learning affordances imply certain learning activities in virtual environments, as we can see with these examples in the parentheses. Now, I borrow Tom DeYoung's saying that designers of instruction can improve outcomes by taking advantage of the affordances of each type of laboratory, and I replace laboratory by virtual reality. Okay? And learning affordances lead or might lead to learning benefits when they are supported by a solid theoretical framework. Okay, what is this framework? Okay, this is about pedagogical reasoning introduced by Shulman. We all know that the teacher has to comprehend the content. He or she has to transform it in a proper way to deliver it to the students. After that, he or she has to teach it, to evaluate the student himself or herself or the whole process, to reflect on them, and the circle goes round and round. Okay, this is the well-known pedagogical content knowledge. Okay, so in order to teach, we have to have content knowledge. In order to teach physics, I have to know physics. But it's not enough, because I have to have pedagogical knowledge, meaning I have to have an approach concerning learning theories, instruction models, strategies. I have to know something about evaluation, about curricula, about the crisis I might meet in a classroom, and so on. So, in order to teach, I have to have pedagogical content knowledge. Now, things are getting harder. Okay, technology is here to help us, but technology makes a teacher's job maybe difficult, because a teacher has to have technological knowledge, not only the skills to write an essay or to use Excel or SPSS, but has to have technological content knowledge, how to use this specific technology, virtual reality or artificial intelligence, in order to teach physics or history. And this is not enough, because the teacher has to have technological, pedagogical knowledge, meaning how to use this specific technology to teach physics. Finally, the teacher has to have technological, pedagogical content knowledge. It's very hard to be a teacher. Okay. So, being a good educator, and I use the term educator because I want to involve both teachers and educational researchers. So, everybody has to have a learning theory to be based on. Okay? And, of course, this learning theory has to be transferred into an instructional model. We have to have the learning objectives and follow a certain taxonomy. For example, this is the revised Bloom taxonomy, the cognitive domain taxonomy. Okay, all these have to be combined in order to choose specific instructional techniques, and here virtual reality or any other technology comes, and we have to combine all this and have learning, or might have learning. Okay, now, our approach to virtual reality in education. We think that virtual environments are cognitive tools or mind tools, meaning that these are environments that are created, modified, or manipulated by the students themselves in order to engage and facilitate critical thinking and higher order learning, or in order to construct and represent their knowledge. Okay, maybe it's difficult for students to create virtual environments, not always, but they can modify them, or very easily they can manipulate them. Okay, so let's have a look on learning affordances of virtual reality, pedagogical reasoning, and action through some specific examples. And the first learning affordance is creation. Okay, the main virtual reality affordances creation is based on are multisensory, intuitive, real-time interaction, and natural semantics. For example, here we can see some physics students working on a virtual laser. I'll show you the example later. Or some primary school students trying to build some primitive objects like houses and trees by using their hands. Okay. So this was a brief study on the interaction of children with virtual environments, and they had to construct this symbol house or tree by picking some of these basic solids. And we had two different groups of students. One group was interacting through the mouse and the keyboard, and the other group was interacting just by picking the virtual objects by their hands, because we use, as we can see here, a very cheap device, the Microsoft Kinect device. Okay, now another example of the learning affordance of creation, it's an educational laser laboratory. This is a constructivist learning environment. It focuses on knowledge construction and not reproduction. It is an authentic task. It is a real-world case-based learning environment. And we had an empirical study in higher education, physics students, and the purpose was to study the quality of interaction, the sense of presence, and the learning outcomes. So we can see here, okay, you see, in our physics department, there is a course on laser physics, and the students solve a series of differential equations. They don't understand their physical meaning. What is it for, or what is the other equation for? By doing this, okay, they are inside the virtual environment. They have to pick the correct parts of a laser system from themselves and assemble the whole laser system and put it in a function. So the equation of a specific kind means the type of mirror the student has to choose in order the laser to fire. So by using this example, students relate abstract concepts with a real world. The second learning affordance, free navigation. Okay? The virtual reality affordances, free navigation is based on are 3D spatial representations, first person user point of view, and first order experiences. And we have two examples. We can see here an example on immersive system. Okay, here the lady is freely navigating in a space representing the real space she's right now. And this is a kitchen. This is technical education, and the students learn how to cook. Okay, concerning this affordance, let's have an example on factors that influence presence. So we build a constructivist learning environment that, again, focuses on knowledge construction. It's a real-world case-based learning environment. It concerns authentic tasks, and it fosters reflective practice. We can see here, and you can see, because of the quality of the graphics, that this system is many, many years old. So it's on an ancient Greek city where the participant has to complete a certain series of tasks people of that time were doing to bring this vessel there, or to light the fire, or to do this and that. Okay? And we had two different versions of the learning environment, where in the first one we had an egocentric view, I'm the participant and I carry the vessel, or an exocentric view where the camera, my eyes, are just before my body. And we had some certain comparisons. The aim of the study was to investigate the sense of presence of 20-year-old pupils in these virtual environments. Okay. And we found that the environmental richness and the high level of interactivity resulted in a high degree of presence. And presence was significantly correlated with pupils' degree of association with their virtual bodies. Let's pass to another learning affordance, modeling and simulation. The main virtual reality affordances this learning affordance is based on are size and transduction and reification. We can model and simulate a real classroom. This is an example on earthquake education. Or we can simulate the planet Mars, and we used some data from NASA in order to model and simulate planet Mars, and we went there before NASA goes there, just a few days, okay? And here we simulate magnetic and electric fields just in order to show you how transduction and reification work. I'll show you a two-dimensional view of the system, and we can see here it's a learning object where I can have one or two charges, electrical charges, positive or negative. I can see their interaction. This can be positive or negative. I can put another charge here, and I can see the forces and the intensity of the electric field, things that are not real, but we use them in order to teach physics. And I can put my charge here and study what's going on. Okay, so as far as it concerns modeling and simulation, we've built a constructivist learning environment concerning the quantum atom of hydrogen, and what we've done is to solve the extremely difficult quantum equations, Schrödinger equations, for certain states of the hydrogen. We put their solutions in a specific software package, and we had the two-dimensional representation of the modeling, and after that we had the three-dimensional model. So I want to show you that a simulation, and in this case a visualization, is not an artistic representation. A simulation imitates reality, meaning that a simulation is based in modeling, meaning that there are a lot of equations solved just that in real time, and I'm able to have this. For example, here I am inside the quantum atom, the hydrogen atom. As you know, the hydrogen atom has only one electron, so here I can feel the possible positions of the electron in its ground state. So, and slowly I can see the whole space where I can find the electron. I can find it close to the...
Excuse me.
Yeah? Yes.
Oh, that's marvelous.
Yes. 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 And we've done it for the ground and some excited states.
Wow.
So this is an immersive environment. So the student wears the goggles and feels being there and looking where the electron is.
Beautiful show. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. And the other learning affordance concerns multi-channel communication. So the main virtual reality affordances based are multi-sensory, intuitive, and real-time interaction, and participants' representation by avatars. Here, we can see some students being in different natural physical spaces communicating verbally, but not only verbally. And here we can see this student communicating non-verbally by with another student being somewhere else. And this is another example on multi-channel communication. We had a study asking the question, do children in the spectrum of autism interact with real-time, emotionally expressive human-controlled avatars? And we tried to put children on the autistic spectrum interacting with a real person or his avatar. And the real person makes some facial expressions that are transferred to his avatar. And we have studied if the child prefers the real person through a Skype, for example, or his avatar. So we had some children in high-functioning and low-functioning autism, and we found that the child the child with high functioning autism showed an interest in interacting with the teacher in all modalities, the avatar, real person, video, although a better acceptance was observed in the modalities involving the ICT tools. We all might know that children, especially children with special needs, like specific and certain environments, and ICT offer one of these environments. But the low-function child did not interact at all with ICT modalities, and he preferred only face-to-face interaction. Okay? And the next affordance is collaboration and cooperation. And this is based on all virtual reality affordances. Here is a project we've done where people from different places meet in a virtual world and multi-user virtual environment and attending a lecture or collaborating. We can see here another example of a multi-user virtual environment. And it's a constructivist, again, it's a constructivist learning environment. And what is the problem? Okay. The problem is that almost every child can solve the right angle triangle. Okay? But when this simple problem is transferred to a real problem, an authentic problem, things are getting hard and hard. Okay, here we have a multi-user virtual environment when the teacher and the two students, the two girls there, meet in the cyberspace in the environment we have designed, and the teacher explains them certain things on the reflection of light and some mathematics. He explains to them the use of a laser, and a parenthesis now, and you can see that by using a multi-user virtual environment, a collaborative virtual environment, we can have and we can do some experiments concerning psychological or sociological aspects, because none of these three are represented as they are in reality. Okay? So, the teacher explains them certain things, and after that, they have to go outside and they have to turn this mirror in order the laser to reflect on it and cut this apple over there. It's not a trial and error problem, but they have to think to solve the triangle and to decide to find the correct angle they have to turn the mirror in order the apple to go down. Okay? So they discuss, the teacher scaffolds them. I have turn the sound off because all these are brick to you. They can use the tables there. You can see there is an interactive whiteboard. They can write there. Okay. Okay, they discuss about the angles, the distances or trigonometry. Before they turn the mirror. Okay. You see the student there. She's like to be in the environment because you can see the nonverbal communication signs. And later on, they fire the laser and they solve the problem. And you can see the lady there. Okay? So the aim of this study was to compare a simple like this one, a laboratory problem-based learning activity implemented in both real and virtual environment in terms of learning outcomes, satisfaction and presence. And we had a sample of 150 undergraduate university students, future teachers, and the results showed that the multi-user virtual environment provided similar learning outcomes and satisfaction to the real world condition. And presence, the feeling of being there, was positively correlated to satisfaction, but not to the learning outcome. You see, our first experiments 10 years ago showed that the feeling, the sense of presence, is connected to learning outcomes. But our recent and others researchers' recent results show that they don't. Okay, and I think this is the last learning affordance, content presentation and delivery, and this is based on all the virtual reality affordances. Here we have a collaborative environment where we can present content. This is a course on SPSS. So this is a student from a place, and all the other students are coming from different cities, places, natural places, and so on. But they can share the same presentation. They can have group works to do, homeworks, or to go to a separate special room to solve collaboratively a certain problem and use this software that is in a computer somewhere in the cyberspace. Okay, they can discuss. Okay, here you can see them. Okay. And another project, the aim of this project was to study the impact of technological factors, user characteristics and didactic strategies on learning, attention and presence, again presence. And this is the example with history. Here you can see a three-dimensional stereoscopic projector some years ago, but we don't use them now. This was extremely expensive, but now we can have a three-dimensional projector, which is very cheap. These are the stereoscopic glasses, and this is the video wall where the virtual environment is projected. Okay? This is the student interacting with a virtual environment by using the mouse and the keyboard or special joysticks and so on. Okay, and here we can see what she is looking at. You understand that this blurred picture is because the environment is stereoscopic and there are two different pictures that compose the final stereoscopic environment. So this is all about the different types of unseen vessels, and the task is to have a tour in a museum, and after that the students have to go outside, dig, find some parts of vessels, try to identify them, red figured or black figured vessels, to identify them regarding their type, and assemble them. And as you can see here they assemble the vessels, and this vessel is just in front of the student and the teacher because of the virtual reality system. Okay, and the results of that study showed that the viewing condition, mono or stereo viewing condition, did not affect attention allocation, suspension of disbelief and spatial presence. So maybe stereoscopic vision is not something very important. Okay? And the learning outcomes are better in the monoscopic viewing condition. Strange. results. Okay? And of course, the didactic strategy has an impact on suspension of disbelief and learning outcomes. Okay, and this is a different example on the stereoscopic perception of women in real and virtual environments. Knowing the results of this study, that maybe stereoscopy is not an important thing, we try to identify this by using EEG measures to see what brain does when we observe a monoscopic or stereoscopic virtual or even real environments. And we have studied the electric brain activity of female students, analyzed them, and we found that in general, the women had a, let's say, similar brain activity in 3D and 2D environments, but there are some statistical differences showing that things are not very simple. And these statistical differences showed that in theta activity, the real and the 3D environments caused similar cognitive processes, while the two-dimensional environment caused an increase of anxiety, maybe indicated that perhaps participants were looking for the third dimension. And beta and gamma brain activity showed that participants perceived the third dimension of the stereoscopic environment as in the real one, something that did not happen in the two-dimensional environment. And our findings indicate that stereoscopic three-dimensional virtual environments seem to approximate the real ones as far as it regards the cognitive processes they cause. So we are looking at this, we continuously looking at this. Now, some concluding remarks. We think that virtual reality, through its unique characteristics and affordances, offers those learning affordances that introduce technology to pedagogical reasoning in a constructive way and lead to learning benefits. And virtual reality offers the spatial environments to navigate, to create, to model and simulate, to communicate, to collaborate and present content in an engaging way. Okay, I'm not a psychologist, you know better. And we think that virtual reality also offers the background to study intuitive and effective ways for students to interact with digital learning environments. So, I think that our approach to virtual learning environments is in line with other researchers' views. Speakers in these schools, speakers we heard today or we will listen to later on. So, our approach is in line with the four component instruction design proposed by Marienbauer, okay? Because we think that virtual reality provides the affordances to change the time scale, to have multiple representation, immediate feedback, and gives the background for authentic real-life problem-solving tasks. We think that we are in line with the Lajoie report on technology-rich learning environments, scaffold learning in complex situations, remember the quantum atom, or even with the Young sayings that both virtual and physical investigations, remember the triangle problem, can meet the goals for investigation in science courses. And Azevedo's remarks on engagement that has been used to describe everything, including student academic performance and achievement, classroom behaviors, and so on. Thank you very much.